Now let us discuss about the quality and quantity of the surface waters and their usefulness for the public water supplies. First, let us take up the quantity. Whenever we speak about the quantity of the available water from the surface water sources is mainly dependent on the rainfall. And in India, rainfall is sufficient, considerable, and therefore there is no scarcity of the water from the surface sources, generally from the surface sources, even though in nowadays rainfall is also quietly varying. But since the rainfall is not uniform and regular spread throughout the year, considerable variations in the available flow do occur during the years. Thus, the available flow in a stream channel or a river may be too high to be controlled or may be too less to fulfill the demand. Storage reservoirs therefore be provided as a good means for storing the water and utilizing the rainwater during the summer season. Generally, we know that during the rainy season, the water that is collected in the river is more, that is creating the devastating floods. There, in such a times, it is very difficult to control the floods. And even in summer seasons, they go dry, creating the scarcity of the water. That is why the best option for using the river water or any surface water is by constructing the storage reservoir in the form of a dam or a barrier. When we provide such a barrier, it creates a pool of water behind the barrier that can be stored throughout the year, and it is used out uniformly throughout the year. Next, let us speak about the quality of the water from the surface sources. The rainwater, though it will be pure in the beginning, but it gets considerably polluted till it reaches the river streams. Many a times, sewage and industrial wastewater gets added to this water, making it contaminated. Inorganic impurities, sometimes like silt, clay, etc., also gets added due to the entry from the beds of the streams and channels. Since we know that the river is a condition where water keeps flowing, the river is the most polluted source when we talk about the surface sources. Next, the organic impurities also gets added along with the inorganic impurities in the form of a vegetable washings, dead organic matter, and also the dead animals, etc. And when we compare inorganic and organic source is very dangerous since it will be decaying with respect to time. Inorganic impurities can be easily removed whenever the particles are greater in size. They generally gets down to the bottom of the river as a sediment sometimes, but it is very difficult to deal with the organic impurities. Compulsorily, we need to remove the organic impurities before we supply it to the public. On the other hand, the algae, weed, and the plant growth in still waters increases enormously, thus giving color and taste to the water. Always, the color and taste is undesirable to the pure water. We know that pure water is colorless, and taste for that is not particular. It doesn't have any particular taste. So usually in the lake and pond, this condition prevails. There is a growth of algae, weed, and the plant. Surface water are, however, generally soft and less corrosive than the groundwater, since because of the presence of less amount of the dissolved inorganic salts. But as we compare with the groundwater or subsurface source, the presence of the inorganic salts will be more. On the whole, the surface supplies are generally contaminated and cannot be used with minor treatment or without any treatment. Therefore, they need a proper treatment before public supplies. So, or otherwise, it may create a health problem in the public. Even the presence of the algae also create a condition called as eutrophication, that is, increased level of the nutrients in the water, sometimes from the agricultural field runoff, also creates a condition that creates more of the growth of the algae. Algae and all such things have to be removed from the water before it is selected as a source of supply. And next, we will discuss about the quality and quantity of the groundwater and its usefulness for the public supplies. When we discuss about the quantity of the groundwater available is generally less than that of a surface sources. The amount of groundwater available at the particular place depends upon the underground storage underground storage and the geological formations of the area and also the substrata. And this available quantity of the groundwater, however, remains fairly constant in different times of the year. This works as a backup but not as a real source of supply, since all the people cannot access the groundwater. Since because of that, even though supply of water is available from the surface sources, this can be kept as a backup whenever there is a scarcity from the surface sources. But it cannot be a regular source of supply, though, since the water that is available from the subsurface sources is very much less. The available quantity of the groundwater, however, remains fairly constant in different times of the year, because this is the water that is stored by the percolation into the ground. This is stored water. Because of that, it will be available in a constant rate. Due to its advantage of better quality and less development of modern purification plants, groundwaters are being largely tapped in India. Even though in the appearance the turbidity will be less and the physical pollution of the water is less, but it will be generally having high amount of the salts. And about 70 to 80% of our population get their supplies from the groundwater sources. But due to excessive use of the groundwater, the water table levels in most part of the country are falling day by day, since we know that continuous exploitation of this water doesn't yield good amount of the water, since water table gets exhausted. And proper conservation, protection and recharge of this vital source is therefore extremely important for us. This also we studied in a rainwater recharge. The importance of that is very much today, since the groundwater recharge to rainwater harvesting is one such method that is contributing to the current water scarcity. And next we'll discuss about the quality of the groundwater. The groundwater supplies are generally purer and safer because the water before getting stored in the underground reservoir undergoes natural filtration during percolation through the soil pores. Whenever it passes through the voids that are smaller in sizes, the any impurities that will be present in the water gets trapped there itself. Only the pure water percolates and reaches the underground source. Because of that natural filtration action, the water quality is generally very good and it will be very less in turbidity. These waters generally are free from suspended impurities and organic matter, which in turn is generally responsible for disease producing bacteria. So there is no such matter which undergoes decay and then which will not be visible to our eyes also. However, they are likely to contain greater amount of dissolved salts and minerals, gases, etc. And these may impart different taste, odors and other properties such as the hardness. We generally say whenever we draw the groundwater, we say it as hard, because whenever the groundwater percolates through the soil, it comes in contact with the soil surrounding rock formations. Because of that, in the water, some amount of the inorganic salts gets dissolved in, just like the calcium, magnesium, carbonates and bicarbonates, that imparts the hardness to the water. Although the quality of the groundwater is quite safe, yet it is advisable to protect these sources from the probable dangers of the pollution. And these waters can be supplied to the public after proper testing with minor treatment or even without the treatment. But some extent of the hardness is allowable, but not extremely hard water can be safe for the drinking. And groundwater has generally found colder in hot seasons and hotter in cold seasons, are thus very useful for the domestic uses. Thank you. Hello everyone. In this video, we will be discussing two major topics from the module 2. One is the objective of water treatment and second one is the operation and the flowchart of the water treatment plant. First, let us discuss about the objectives of the water treatment. What is the meaning of the objective of water treatment? This is the question wherein we are asking why we need to treat the water. See, we invest a lot of money and our time in order to make the water to be safe for the drinking and by giving the water treatment. Why we need to do this? This can be answered as below. And the principal objective of the water treatment is to provide a potable water that is chemically, biologically safe for the human consumption. Since we know that the water is a prime thing for the living of the human being, but we need it to make a safe source of supply. So to make it safe for drinking and all other purpose, it should be chemically and biologically safe. First objective is that one. And then we can go in particular, what are the things that we don't want in the water? We need to remove color, objectionable taste, and also the odor. We know that pure water is colorless. Whenever there is a presence of color, it indicates the impurity. Always the physical pollution is more objectionable than the chemical pollution, since it will be visible to our eyes. Since because of that, we can't consume the water which is physically polluted. Even it is having any objectionable taste due to some decaying matter, that is also need to be rectified. And also the presence of the odor. Pure water is odorless. If it is having any sort of the odor, it indicates the presence of any sort of a decaying matter that starts creating any objectionable gases. We need to remove some amount of the physical pollution from the water. Next is to remove the dissolved gases. The dissolved gases includes oxygen, but oxygen is a needed thing in the water, but we want to remove the other impure gases that we don't want in the water, such as the carbon dioxide, presence of the H2S gas, other sulfur gas, nitrogen gas, all such gases that will be present in the water. Dissolved gases, dissolved and suspended impurities, and also the harmful minerals. Some of the minerals that will be present in excess, for example, presence of the fluoride is more harmful for consumption. But all of the minerals and the inorganic salts present in the water have some limit, as according to the Bureau of Indian Standards. When they exceed the permissible limits, we call them as harmful. Then in such a scale, we need to bring them into the limits, and then it can be selected for a source of supply. Next is to remove suspended and dissolved organic impurities. Here we talked about the inorganic portions. So it may include salts or even the sand, silt particles, all such particles. Some of them may be dissolved. Some of them may be suspended in the water. And here we are talking about the removal of the suspended and dissolved organic impurities. Organic impurities are one which undergo decaying with respect to the time. This is always dangerous in the water, since it deteriorates the quality of the water. It may have entered through some of the living or any decaying particles, such as the leaf debris or else any food sources. Usually in the villages they wash the utensils. All such activities generally contribute some amount of the organic impurities to the water. Even sometimes it may be due to the animals also. Next is to remove the harmful bacteria. This is very important, since it may give rise to outbreak of the diseases. We need to remove harmful bacteria, since we know that many a sources of water are generally used for washing the cows. Even some of the human waste also gets entered into the water source, that creates the entry of E. coli bacteria, that is mainly arising from the human waste into the water. That is very dangerous in the water. It may create diseases such as cholera. That is why we need to remove all such harmful bacteria that are present in the water. We know for many diseases, water is the main source that carries the bacteria. That is why we need to make it safe. Next is to make the water safe and attractive for drinking and domestic purpose. Not only for drinking and even also for the domestic purpose, which includes all the activities like bathing, cooking, gardening, all such activities. In order to make the water safe for that purpose also, we need to treat the water. And also it may contain some of the toxic elements, which even in a low concentration may be dangerous to human body. To remove all such components, we go for a treatment of a water. Next, we will be discussing about the flowchart of the water treatment plant. Before going on to the water treatment plant, let us check how the water is brought up to from the source up to the people. So first is the selection of the source. Already we discussed which source we have to select, what is the quality and quantity condition with respect to each of the sources, and also few conditions are there that we need to concentrate whenever we are considering some source as a source of supply. So next is the from the source we take the water through the intake well, as shown in the figure. Next is, from the intake well, the water is taken to the treatment plant From the treatment plant, water is taken to the storage tank. Figures are has shown. And then from the storage tank, it is taken to the distribution system and distributed throughout the city or a village. Next is the flowchart of the water treatment plant. These are some of the units that comes in the water treatment units, various units. First is the raw water. Raw water is brought to the screen. Screen is as shown in the figure. As we can see in the figure, screen, either it may be a bar screen or I'll say it may be a perforated screen. The intention of providing the screen is to remove all such suspended impurities which are greater in size, and they may be objectionable if it is allowed to flow further units. It may create misfunctioning of the pumps, and also it may affect the working of various units. For example, it may be cloth racks, pieces of the paper, and even it may be a plastics. All such particles has to be removed from the water. For that purpose, we provide the screen. From the screen, we remove the water. From the screen, the water is taken further. In between, we add the coagulant. Coagulant is a chemical that is added to the water that creates a flock-like substance. And whenever a flock-like substance, such as imagine this is an impurity, around this the flock or the sticky material goes sticked out. This is the particle and this is the layer that is of the coagulant. Whenever it gets sticked like this, the weight of the particle gets increased. Because of that, it will be attracted to the gravity and it comes to the bottom and settles down. This is the advantage by adding the coagulant. Even though the particles which cannot be removed by the normal sedimentation can be removed by adding the coagulant. Here we are providing one unit, we call it as a coagulation unit. And here in this case, the added coagulant is mixed thoroughly in the water so that all the particles, suspended particles, comes in contact with the coagulant and forms the flock. And then this water is taken to the sedimentation unit. Before taking to the sedimentation unit, we also can provide one additional treatment, that is, we call it as a aeration. This is optional. Aeration is a treatment wherein we aerate the water by increasing the dissolved oxygen content in the water. Either you can take water directly from the coagulation unit to the sedimentation, or we can take the water to the aeration and then we can take the same water into the sedimentation unit. Aeration has so many benefits, such as it increases the oxygen content in the water. Increased oxygen content makes the water fresh, and also it helps in removing the various dissolved gases. It helps in removing the iron and manganese salts, and also it purifies the water to some extent. Even some of the color gets removed in the aeration process, and then we can take the same water into the sedimentation unit. Sedimentation, as the name itself is saying, the sediment, it is a process wherein we remove the sediment particles. We give some retention time to the water, which means we give some rest to the water in certain pre-measured tank wherein some amount of rest is given. With that amount of rest, water is brought to rest, and the particles which are heavier in size, due to the attraction by the gravity, they come to the bottom and get settled in the bottom. The particles which are settled in the bottom, we call them as a sludge, and it is periodically removed, and then further it is given some treatment. Here, the water from the sedimentation tank is taken to the filtration. Filtration, there are varieties of the filters like slow sand filters, rapid sand filters. Now the pressure filters are most commonly used since we want output more easily. Here, generally it contains various beds like beds of the sand, beds of the aggregates. So whenever the water is made to percolate through such beds, only the water can enter through the particles, in between the particles, and the other impurities gets arrested in between the particles. Because of that, only the pure water comes out of the filter. After the water that comes out from the filter, we go for a disinfection action in order to kill all the unwanted pathogenic organisms that is present in the water. In order to do that, we can go for varieties of the options such as adding the chlorine in the form of a gas or in the form of bleaching powder, or else we can go for a UV treatment, ozone treatment. But since many of the other methods except the bleaching powder or a chlorine addition method are costly, we generally choose chlorination as the best method for the disinfection. Some amount of the chlorine is injected whenever water moves from filtration unit to disinfectant basin. Here it is injected, here it is given some contact time in the basin, and then the water that is disinfected is taken to the storage. After it is taken to the storage, it is further distributed throughout the city. This is the complete water treatment flowchart.